So, hello everybody. I welcome you to our today's session of the lecture series Digital Sustainability Transformation of, by, and for the TUM. And these sessions are organized by us, the Professorship of Public Policy of the TUM School of Governance at the TUM. So, today we have already arrived at the penultimate event of the semester. And today we will have the topic called Universities as Urban Ecosystems, and we titled the event Greening the City, Ecology, Design and Participation. This lecture is part of the third block of our lecture series covering the ecological dimension. And for this highly relevant topic, we've invited two experts of the TUM, and we are really proud that they are here today to give us more insights about this topic and answer all of our and your questions. So I will briefly start with introducing our experts, and then I will hand over to them. So maybe, although, yeah, now she's here, but I will start with Professor Egerer. So she joined the TUM School of Life Sciences, and more specifically, the Professorship for Urban Productive Ecosystems just last year. Her research interest is the ecology and management of production-oriented ecosystems in and around cities. And she follows a very interesting and interdisciplinary approach and combines issues of biodiversity, environmental and climate protection, and socio-ecological issues in urban and agricultural systems. Before coming to TUM just last year, she studied environmental studies at the University of California in Santa Cruz for her PhD. And she came to Germany in 2019, where she joined the Institute of Ecology at the TU Berlin as a postdoctoral fellow. So welcome, Professor Egerer. And then our second guest is Professor Ferdinand Ludwig. He is Professor for Green Technologies in Landscape Architecture at the TUM. And his research focuses on architectural concepts and how plants can be included in this. And the aim of integrating plants into construction designs is to provide an answer to many ecological concerns like the climate change. And he studied architecture and completed his doctoral degree at the University of Stuttgart. And in 2007, he founded the research group Baubotanik at the University of Stuttgart's Institute of Architectural Theory and Design, and he headed this group as a research associate with until 2017. So thanks a lot for joining us today. And I will now. Yeah, so this was the introduction, and I think we agreed on, as I understood this correctly, that Professor Ludwig is going to start, right? And maybe some last comments from my side. So I encourage you again to hand in already questions during the presentation of the two via the Q&A button at the bottom. Yeah, so this helps me to moderate the discussion, and I hope that you can then get as many information of this lecture as possible. And yeah, so as you already probably realized, we will record this lecture again, and it will be available then again on our YouTube channel. So now, was it from my side? And yeah, I hand over to Professor Ludwig. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. Thank Thank you very much for this kind introduction, and also both of you, also Markus, for this invitation, and also Monika for bringing me into this. I will directly start to share some slides, and I'm very looking forward to all your questions and discussions afterward. And if there's some important question in between, I think it's also fine to interrupt me, Lea, if you want. You can also throw in a question in the meantime, if you think this is helpful. I will share my screen, which you should see now. You already know from the introduction that I am an architect by training, and this I would like to start from with a mission statement saying we can no longer limit ourselves to creating buildings that are less impactful on the environment. We must instead create buildings that help reverse the current trend and ultimately contribute to the regeneration of the environment. Especially in the urban context, this means maximizing interaction. Every surface of a building must be multipurpose and facilitate ecological and social processes. Facade and roofs must not only provide habitats for flora and fauna, but buildings must also play an active role, e.g. in improving the water balance and microclimate of a city. And to this, they must be dynamic. This being a statement from an architect, from a designer, partly is common sense at the moment, but partly is also not, because especially this dynamic aspect of architecture normally is rejected by the designers, because we are normally shaping form and creating objects and not processes, which is very different to ecologists. And now in the last years, I have shifted to landscape architecture, where I'm standing now in between these different worlds, which is a great fun to work and is a platform for many interdisciplinary collaborations. So by this statement, you can also already see that we are kind of shifting away from the classical definition of sustainable design, where we are more trying to be less bad to the environment, and we are trying to be more good for the environment. And this is related to the definition of regenerative design. The aim of regenerative design is to develop systems that allow for the co-evolution of the human species along with other thriving species, creating a better world than that we humans found. So this also puts us away from the center and brings us in line with other forms of life. And defining architecture, the object of my study, not anymore as a built object, but as a system, as a dynamic changing system, and specifically with the project and the topic of biobotanic, designing living buildings with trees, we really combine the object building and the object tree to a new holistic element in urban life. I'm doing this as a practicing designer, so I have an office collaboration in Stuttgart since many years, and I'm doing this as a researcher, going more deeper on the ground of these things. So I'm mainly doing research by design, through design, and also for design. And my teaching as a professor is also very much related to this design and research. We have a quite diverse research agenda at the Professorship for Green Technologies and Landscape Architecture. I'm listing our main topics here. So this is just giving an overview. I'm underlining here now some of these, which I will go through in my presentation today, that I'm mainly focusing on this digital transformation, but also on this urban intervention that might have a relation also to our TUM campus. So what we are doing, we are investigating historic forms of living architecture to derive future concepts. And for doing so, we are developing digital tools for designing with living systems or living systems themselves. We are doing this by exploring the interaction between building and growing not just by theoretical investigations, but also by one-by-one prototyping. And we are exploring the corresponding workflows and design strategies for living architecture, but also for aspects like blue-green architecture. I will come to this definition in a second. The first two aspects are presented, can be presented very well by a design research studio that we have undertaken in the last winter term 2021 with a group of interdisciplinary students, architects and landscape architects. And this really shows very well the general approach we are following. We were starting from our research on historic forms of living architecture. This is one of our study topics. These are the so-called living root bridges of the Khasi people in India. And from my perspective, they are fantastic example for an interactive architecture. They are formed by the collaboration of humans and trees, as you can see here on that picture. I can't explain the whole process of the emergence of this structure in this short lecture, but in principle, the growth of roots is guided over rivers and they are woven together into this hybrid structure and growing stronger and stronger over time. And they depend on each other. The human system is depending on the natural ecosystem, and the natural system is also depending on the human work input. In the last years, we have tried to understand this interaction and development by classical architectural means. You can see here drawings, digital drawings, hand drawings, and down left, you can also see a physical model of such a form of historic living architecture. This all helped us to get an understanding of the structure, but it was by far not enough to really understand the complexity. So we directly shifted to digital tools. We were applying photogrammetry mainly to generate dense point clouds of these super complex structures. You see, for example, here the so-called double-decker bridge, which is roughly 20 meters long and has two stories where you can walk in these trees, or other bridges which have been documented over sequences of time to follow the changes in this very undulated geometry and complexity. And we also have, based on this, developed abstraction processes to understand the geometry in depth, to understand the inner structure of such complex shapes in order to be able to make, for example, structural calculations, but also in order to make forecasts of future development. This is a historic investigation, as I said, and we are also doing this not only from this technical perspective, geometrical perspective, but we also try to do it more from a holistic perspective. We try to understand this example of living architecture with tools and methods that are provided from the discipline of regenerative design. For example, we try to evaluate different aspects reaching from material aspects to beauty, land use, or health and well-being of humans by a qualitative judgment. In this paper I'm citing here, to really get an overview both of the hard facts but also of the soft facts of such structures. And from this, we wanted to start to design new living projects. The most important thing that we have learned from this interaction of humans and trees, with Khasi people and their trees, is at first that it is a very long-term process. Second, that it is never finished. And third, that it is a kind of a ping pong between two actors, the natural actor, the tree, and the human actor, the designer and maker. And we wanted to translate this kind of interplay into our current design environment. We wanted to adapt it to digital tools. And we did this by this studio. The starting point was a living pavilion that was started by a friend of mine, the artist Cornelius Hackenbach, several years ago. He was starting to grow the plants. You can see here on this photo. It was just an intermediate state with a quite undescribable geometry in classical ways. So we asked the students, how can we co-design with these trees? How can we react to these existing forms and shape? How can we adapt any technical means? We wanted to have a roof to these existing situations. And how can we initiate future development by this intervention? So just intervening in this time process. We did this in the middle of the lockdown, so no student could go, and we were fully depending on digital tools. We again went to photogrammetry and made a fully 3D model of the whole site, especially of the very complex tree structure that was then abstracted and simplified by the students, dividing the branches in different categories, those that should be bent, those that should be stayed, those that should be cut away, those that should grow, and so on and so forth, and trying to understand just what we have there at the moment. And from this, making a suggestion for a design of a roof that directly is taking advantage of what we find. So this is not a classical building as we understand it normally in architecture. This has no foundation or something like this. This has no technical structure to lift up the roof. It's all depending on the tree growth. And even the roof structure itself is not stable enough to withstand the weather conditions without the internal support of branches. So it's a very, very fragile and light construction that we are suggesting. You can see this here. We have suggested a skin of shingles. And under this 3D truss framework of very thin 8mm steel elements that are incorporated in the living structure and are growing and merging with this structure over time. This is then the technical part you can see here. This was developed on a parametric way by the students. And then it was, again, directly produced. So we are hands-on architects. We do not just make 3D models. We also are very much interested in the physical interaction with the material, that the plan is popping out of the computer directly into the construction site or in the construction hall for prefabrication in this case. You can see the students here at work in our in the school's workshop that was rented for this, or is rented in general, and we could use this for this project. And then it is the technical part is made. You can see elements here, painted elements, and then is brought to construction site, and the interaction with the tree starts. You can see one student climbing on this very fragile structure that is purely supported by these trees. And it surprisingly perfectly matches. So without any digital tools, there would be no chance to create such a fragile structure that is exactly strong enough to support itself, but needs the trees to be strong enough in the future for holding a roof, for holding snow, for holding wind, for protecting, but which is also exactly adapted to the shape of these trees. What the Kasi people with their bridges are doing intuitively, we are trying to do now. We are trying to remake this with a digital means that come to life in this project. But as I said, this is not the end. This is just thinking in future processes. We can't add the shingles of this roof now. We have to wait until the trees are strong enough and until they have reached diameter and connection stability that they hold this additional load. And then we do not know exactly how the shape will develop. It might go more in a wild scenario with less maintenance, or with a more curated scenario with higher maintenance. We might have impacts from wind, from breaking branches, whatever, that we can't expect. And we have to interact with these fundamental natural processes. For me, this is a key for sustainability in architecture, that we start really to think in time, no matter if it is about tree growth or if it is about other forms of architecture. If we are not able to understand also the meaning of life cycle by thinking in these whole processes, we will not be able to deal with resources in a proper way. So this was the first glimpse, snapshot into a project, and there's a second one. A completely different project has nothing to do with tree growth. It is focusing on this very, very pressing aspect of climate change, but also is dealing with green architecture. It is focusing on the water issue. We have this controversial situation at the moment that we, on the left hand, you can see these very heavy stormwater events flooding everything. And these are complemented then by these extending droughts where nature, where the green in cities is suffering from too less water. And in this project, we were trying to bring these things together in a two-sided approach. Normally, you mainly are addressing one problem from one side. For example, flood protection. You try to reuse water and maybe you can use it for vegetation. Or you start with a green design and you want to have a green skyscraper or something like this. And then you are creating a water demand and you are looking for a water source. But an integrated design approach, we want to solve both problems immediately at the same time. Striving for synergies between the water demand and the water need and the water problem with too much water. We wanted to exemplify this in a very small build project. This is in Stuttgart, where I come from, in an area of an urban development where a city, whole city quarter is developed, and we wanted to install this small blue-green intervention to show that it is possible. We wanted to test out the design approach. We wanted to test the design procedure, the interdisciplinary and iterative workflow to inspire future architects, urban planners, but also the municipality to shift from a more gray approach into a blue-green approach for this city quarter. This situation is very unique, very urban in a way. It is an urban transformation area with artists temporarily occupying an industrial hall, but also working a lot of in many containers while this industrial hall was renovated. There's also urban agriculture, a project called Stadtacker, and there are these habitation containers for workers of the so-called Stuttgart 21 construction site, tunnel workers that are really suffering hard in these very difficult living conditions in such containers, being quite cold in the winter and hot in the summer. And our idea was to deal with this unique stakeholder constellation in a special way. We were using the gray water. This is the wastewater from showers and so on, from these workers that come out of that construction, showering every day and then going to bed suffering with the heat in their container habitation. Using this, cleaning it, combining it with the rainwater to also reduce the load in the sewer system, and bringing it back to the facade by irrigation for facade greening to cool down the container atmosphere, the container climate. So basically, based on their wastewater, they are improving their life quality. This being said, this is directly made. You can see a modular element that we have developed. This is a transportable constructed wetland that is installed on site. And there's a cistern, and there are these green elements, and there's also the soil that is coming in for this constructed wetland. And then it's done. You can directly see it here. We have the vertical greening, we have the rainwater, we have the cistern that doubles up for advertising the concept. We have the constructed wetland here. We have the water storage. You can go on the water storage as a terrace. And we have a technical container for all the research stuff. And here the gray water is coming, and then it is brought to this facade. By this, we have been creating interaction between many stakeholders. We have created the platform. As designers, we have created the platform for other researchers to investigate the water treatment and so on. And we have created platform for a participatory approach to discuss with the inhabitants and future inhabitants of this city quarter how and in which direction this project should develop in the future. This was the second project. I think I was speaking a bit longer than expected, so I will skip the third that I had prepared. I might be able to bring in this in the discussion if needed. With this, I would like to end, and I could now answer questions or hand over to Monika.
Yes, so thanks a lot. So maybe we will ask Monika beforehand and start with her presentation, and then afterwards we will collect all the questions.
Okay, Monika, should I share my screen with your slides?
I think I got in.
I
had to re-download Zoom, and then I kept on just pressing enter to get into the system. So now I'm here. Fantastic. Let's see if it works. Can I share my screen? Am I able?
Yeah, I think it should work. Yeah.
Okay. Do you see presentation mode, or is it the presentation?
Like, we can see the presentation, but at least for me, the left side is black, kind of. Maybe it's also just me.
I also have half a slide on the right, and on the left, it's black.
Yeah. Okay. Let me try again.
Now I can. It was just there.
And maybe I will move this. What do you see now? You probably still see.
Mainly white.
Now it's just white, yes.
Weird. Okay.
Now it's the presentation mode.
And now?
Yeah, here we are.
Okay, great. All right, sorry about that. So apologies for my technical difficulties today. This is a little bit embarrassing, but it's good to be here. Thank you so much for the invitation and to present, I guess, on the more ecology and participation a little bit. And a little bit of design in this lecture series, greening, or this lecture topic today, greening the city, ecology, design, and participation. And so, as Leah kindly mentioned, I am a new professor of urban productive ecosystems, and I've been at the TUM in the School of Life Sciences based in Freising since October in 2020. So just a little brief introduction, because some of you may have absolutely no idea who I am, and to give you some context for why I'm here today. So my training is in biodiversity, ecology, and conservation. And so when I was when I was a student, I was really interested in insects and insect ecology and how we can protect them in the natural world. And during my studies, I saw two huge global change factors occurring around me. So both industrial agriculture, I grew up in Michigan, and we are, also plagued with a lot of soybean, corn, huge fields. And I saw this really, as a big transformation of our landscapes, and also urbanization. So a majority of the world's population lives in urban areas, and our cities and the impervious surface, even though it remains a very small fraction of the world's surface, is growing. And so these are two big changes occurring around us. And so I got really interested in two things, both diversified farming systems and diversified urban habitats, and both of these as a way to somehow ameliorate these rapid land use changes occurring to support biodiversity and to conserve the species that are losing their habitat. So this kind of brought me to where I am today, or I guess that's a big jump, but into thinking about urban green spaces and why the title of our seminar today is, or the focus is, thinking about the greening of the city. So when we think about urban green, we may think of, using this example of Central Park in the middle of New York City. We may also think about parks like an English Garden that is in Munich, where many people may spend their warm Saturdays and Sundays. Or we also have these novel ecosystems on the top of roofs. And so all of these are a form of urban green. And these don't just have to be these big parks or these big forest reserves, maybe on the side of cities, or have to be on rooftops that are managed by companies, but they could also be very small scale gardens or farms that people manage from their balconies or in their backyards. And so here, I really love, even though it's now been there's a big tarp over where this picture used to be, Olympia Dorf, where you can see all of the different balconies are like little mini ecosystems. And so this is also a form of urban green. And another important part of, or another urban greenery or urban green system that I have just alluded to, is agricultural systems, or urban agriculture or urban gardening, depends on the scale that you want to think about. And I also got very interested in urban agriculture as a ecological, but also as a social system. Growing up near Detroit, Michigan, urban farming has become a tool for the city to revitalize its neighborhoods. And this is something that Leah and Marcus and I talked about a little bit when we started thinking about this lecture series. And so urban farms across Detroit have sprung up to revitalize neighborhoods, to give people access to fresh and affordable foods. But these are also now a part of our urban group, are of the, of the urban green systems across the city landscape. And here are just some other pictures at a local level, and just to also give a face to the people that are managing these green systems. So when you think, when it comes to your mind, what is urban agriculture? You may think of these farms that I just mentioned. But we may also think about community gardens. So this is another very popular form of urban agriculture, where a community organizes a community organizes, and each person may have their own bed that they manage. But we may also think about a backyard, in this case, a beer barrel that was revitalized or used to grow tomatoes in. So these are all different scales of urban agriculture. And I just want to, the main take home is that these are very heterogeneous systems. And so urban agriculture is very diverse in its form and its functions, and ranges across the world from gardens to orchards and to rooftops that are designed and used for food, but also other horticultural products. And what I will, yeah, hopefully leave you with today is that urban agriculture is a multifunctional urban greening strategy. And we can think about this at the global scale. We can think about this at the city scale for Munich, and we can think about this at the campus scale. And these are, yeah, urban agriculture is a movement that is excitingly happening at on the TUM campus with the Plant a Seed community garden that I will use as an example. And hopefully there are also some folks in the room from Plant a Seed that can give their own project or give their project its personal voice. So urban farming can provide nourishment to millions of people across the world, but also provides many other benefits. So we can think about food security provided through local production. This is very important for people from low-income backgrounds. And also very important in what we consider, at least in English, food deserts. So we may have green deserts or neighborhoods with very little access to public green space to recreate in or to relax in. But also we may think of food deserts where there may be not a grocery store where you can get access to fresh and organic affordable food within your nearby vicinity. Urban agriculture also is important during times of crisis, which is interesting in what we've seen during the corona pandemic. And it may also build social capital in communities. And this is another very important benefit and often why people may get involved in community gardens, because this is a place where they can make friends or build a sense of belonging to a neighborhood or a space in the city. From an ecological perspective, I think urban agro ecosystems is what I will formally call them, can provide habitat in what may otherwise be a very desolate urban landscape for insects or birds or small mammals, because they provide habitat through offering floral resources for pollinators, but also nesting structures. So a majority of bees in Germany are solitary and need twigs or need bare soil or sandy soil to nest in. And that's a really important life history characteristic of these animals. And so if urban agricultural systems are designed or managed accordingly, they can provide these kind of habitat structures for the biodiversity of our city. And by providing habitat for biodiversity, we can support many what we would consider ecosystem functions. So pollination as a very easy and often used example between pollinator like a bee or a butterfly and a flower. And this is also important in urban food production. We also saw a little bit before about how these green spaces in cities can support microclimate processes like urban cooling. And so the vegetation within a urban garden, like this community garden in Mitte in Berlin, can provide some sort of cooling benefit within this neighborhood that's surrounded by a lot of buildings and has very little green space. And this can, even though there's been very few studies on this and we need more research on this to be able to make these concrete statements, so I will say this is not a concrete statement, but can have benefits to the surrounding neighborhood climate. So we can have these microclimate benefits within an urban agricultural site, but this may be able to have potential cooling benefits across a neighborhood. And so all of these underlie many ecosystem services or these benefits that we as urban residents derive from an ecosystem or ecological processes. So these are just some of these services that are relevant in urban agriculture. And so I've said some of these benefits, but I think what I would say is that these sites add multifunctionality to an urban landscape. So as I just mentioned, these are social spaces. These are also ecological spaces, potentially by adding habitat for biodiversity. And so these are then multifunctional from social ecological perspectives. And ideally, we can add urban agricultural systems into our urban landscapes to add this multifunctionality and to ideally then promote synergies among certain benefits or certain functions like pollination or pest control or climate regulation or food production. So just to illustrate, I realized after I'd made these text-heavy slides that I should show some pictures because Ferdinand and I discussed how important pictures are. Thinking about urban heat island, we can add just simply more vegetation into our cities to help reduce the urban heat. And social benefits, right? By having sense of community, as well as adding these aesthetic benefits like flowers to a garden or a farm. And yeah, I think that these can be very important, habitats in times or systems in times of stress or crises. And personally, I've seen a lot of very interesting social movements arising during the COVID-19 pandemic around urban farming and gardening. And I think it will be very interesting to see what happens after the pandemic and whether or not these new hobbies that have arisen during a lockdown can maintain their popularity. And yeah, I guess I didn't. Yeah, so this was just to show that this is also a relevant urban greening strategy during this time where we're seeing these kind of practices happening within our communities and also within our backyards. So just to show a little bit about what our research team is doing on trying to understand urban agricultural systems, we are really interested in the biodiversity of these urban systems. And we have focused a lot on insects and looking at the diversity of pollinators and how they interact with flowers. So here is Astrid trying to catch and identify some bees within a garden in Grünspitz. So if anyone has been to the Giesinger Grünspitz in Munich, this is a community garden that we work in. And so she is looking to document what species is visiting what flower. And then Julia also, who is leaning and observing strawberry plants in a garden, is trying to understand what may be important insects that visit and potentially pollinate these strawberry plants. And we're also really interested in understanding, okay, what are the specific resources that urban gardeners may provide for pollinators in this case? So whether they're providing insect hotels or nesting structures, but also floral resources for bees. We also look at ecosystem function. So I talked about pollination before. And so this is a master's student in our group who's trying to investigate how the bee diversity or pollinator diversity and abundance in a site may influence pollination, again, of these strawberry plants. And so we close or put little bags on strawberry flowers and then leave other flowers open to pollination. And then eventually we'll be able to say, okay, what is the production benefits of potential pollinators in a garden or farm? We also look at climate regulation. So we set up these not so fancy, but just very basic temperature loggers that document the hourly temperatures and the light intensity that a site may receive. So again, this is Heen who's standing next to these temperature loggers at the Werksviertel, if anyone has been to this area. yeah, I would, you can check out our stations there because they're open to the public. And then Christian is also another student who's trying to understand, okay, how do these temperatures and these potential stressors of urban heat island or light intensity, how may that affect the vigor of trees in these sites? And then we're also interested in learning about people's values, perceptions, and management decisions. So we ask people, what are specific practices that you use? What do you think about some of these animals that we are interested in observing through our ecological research, to try and also understand, okay, what are these, what are the social dimensions behind the patterns of biodiversity of plants and animals that we may observe? And the participatory part of our research is that we are integrating citizen science. So we want to have gardeners involved in the research process and in understanding what is the importance of these urban green systems. And so here we designed a project where folks measure the pollination phenology on their crops and can then measure each week how their plants are growing and producing fruits that they can hopefully then enjoy. And our goal is then to create information that is not just interesting from an ecological perspective, but also can be applied in urban gardening or urban farming practices. And I think right now is a really exciting time because there's so many citizens or residents that are so energized about insect conservation or pollinate, save the bees or save the butterflies. So this is just one urban gardener who I had to take her photo because she has this really great monarch t-shirt on. And so I think, yeah, people are really looking for information about how they can transform their urban habitats to be, yeah, productive for themselves and produce fruits and vegetables, but also be productive from a biodiversity conservation standpoint. So how can we also design urban gardens and farms to create synergies between conservation and food production, which are often pegged at odds in the agricultural or the conservation literature? So here's just one example of gardeners that used our research results last year and were inspired by our research to create an insect habitat in their urban farm. And so this is, I think, this is a nice example of how we can start to put these ideas into practice and how we can give residents the tools or even just a little bit of information or inspiration to transform their backyards or their community gardens or their rooftop farms. And so to bring this back to TUM and to bring this back to campus greening initiatives that are already happening around us, I'll give a huge shout out to the Plant a Seed Project, which has been started by a group of very engaged students at TUM that have a vision to create a productive ecosystem and a green space within within the campus. And so here I'll just bringing some photos from their Instagram, because I think this is a great way to document the kind of work that they're doing, is that they designed a community garden on the campus, built out of these, or created out of these raised beds that they will be cultivating over the next, hopefully, years to come. But I've already started to plant many different crops, from tomatoes to beans to peppers to squash. And I think that this is also a very nice social ecological or example of a social ecological initiative of how campus greening doesn't just mean, you know, installing a hedge or planting a tree, but it can be a very, yeah, I would say, inspirational endeavor where you have students come together as a group and organize amongst themselves to put something into practice. And so this is a quote from Felix, who says what the Plant a Seed project has told him and told, I guess, the rest of their community of gardeners. So this is, for them, an adventure. I think they're all learning a lot in this initiative. And I'll be excited to see how these raised beds that have started just along the side may take over the entire concrete paved area. Maybe not, but hopefully we'll see. And I think that this is just a nice initiative that and a nice example of campus greening happening already. And bringing some life into what is otherwise a very impervious area. So here are just some examples, and thank you to Veronica and the rest of the Plant a Seed group for letting me use these photos. And just to say that, we are also following along with our research to see, and installing these trap nests for bees to see how this greening initiative may also promote biodiversity and add habitat for twig nesting bee species. So I've probably talked above my time. I can't even see what time it is, but just to think about what ways forward, I'm excited to talk in the rest of this discussion about how to green the campus, how to green TUM, how to green our cities generally. I think this is a really exciting time and there's a lot of potential. What Ferdinand has also developed from an architect and a design perspective is super interesting. And hopefully we can implement more of these ideas on our campus. So with that, maybe I will just end there. And I will thank you all for listening in and happy to take questions.
Thanks a lot, Monika. And I was also very happy to see, or because I had the same impression that people are getting into urban gardening a lot more since the pandemic. So this was so nice to see that this was not only a feeling from my side. So maybe to start off, I was wondering how, because we've heard now what Professor Ludwig was saying, so he's more in the architectural side and you are more in urban farming. So how can you collaborate in your work on a daily basis? Are there intersections and how does this work in practice or,
You want to start, Monika, or should I?
If you have a good response, I mean, Ferdinand and I are already working together, but maybe Ferdinand, if you have good ideas of how urban agriculture can be better integrated into some of your designs, which sounds like you're already doing. So,
First of all, I think we should mention that we are crossing fingers for a collaboration project that should come, where we want to learn from historic forms of urban agriculture and other forms of use of plants, manipulating them, getting use out of that, and transferring them, these learnings into a innovative design approach together with other partners. There are very many possibilities of intersection if we just think about, for example, of the productivity of trees, also in terms of fruit trees. The espalier technique is a very old technique that is very close to my biobotanic work and fully falls into Monika's work. So I can also see such applications on the campus. We had recently been asked by students if we couldn't do something on this very nice roof terrace we have here in the main campus with trees and other plants for shading. And my vision of that would be that should be developed like a food forest with different levels and stories of underground base plants and then shading plants on top and so on, where we do not only have one ecosystem service, but a multifunctionality that is very key. So we are very much focusing on these architectural functions and aspects, but without also more these atmospheric and interactive things Monika was pointing out, we would lose track, I would say. So we would become as boring as normal architecture. So it's very important that we have this give and take between the plant and the human, that is both expressed in allotment gardens as well as in the bridges of the Kasi people I have presented.
Yeah, I think that that's an excellent answer. I think I would just say, yeah, I mean, I think there's also just a lot to learn about, yeah, how we can actually better design green spaces into or on top of buildings. And I know that there are challenges when it comes to having especially soil-based systems, so urban farms on a rooftop, just because of the mass, the sheer mass of plants and of soil and of this material. So I think that that's where new designs and new technologies are more and more important for how we can elevate urban agriculture, for example. But that being said, there's also, as Ferdinand mentioned, there's so much to learn from these past techniques about managing fruit trees that we can still implement or that we can readily implement or seek to implement in today's urban green systems.
Then maybe we come to the first question from the audience. This is mainly for Professor Ludwig. So, and referring to the example of the roof, I think, of the trees. So the question is, waiting several decades until a building is finally ready is not really useful to current needs, although it might be faster than building an airport, train station in Germany, especially coming from Stuttgart. So for which applications would such a living system design make sense? It's a very critical question, but maybe you also have an answer here.
Yeah, sure. Very, very clever and very important questions. I have just put two links in the chat. I don't know if the audience can all see these chats or links, or maybe you can share this. This is two links to YouTube talks I have given the last years, or documentaries. The first is on this TED talk I gave at TUM 2 years ago or so, when we were still meeting physically, before the pandemic. And there I am explaining accurately this discrepancy between the very, very long delay of such projects and the fact that we need solutions here and now. This is totally different to the situation we have in this historic environment, where nothing was changes over many generations, or there was a father planting a tree and his son was making the bridge and the grandson then was using the bridge, which is super sustainable in a way. But it only works in traditional societies where we are inheriting the practices of daily life. Now everything is changing and we need to adapt now. Now the city is overheating and we have to find answers. And what we developed is a technique that is called plant addition. We, for example, used in one project, the plane tree cube. We have realized several years ago, roughly 1,200 plants as young elements to create a green structure immediately with the volume, with the green volume of a 60-year-old tree. So we are speeding up the process drastically by the use of technology, but at the same time relying on the performative and processual approach of the tree. So this is not just building greening where you have to water every day for all over the lifetime. This is just a kickstart of a process that is developing into a stronger and also more resilient structure in the future. So for me, this is very important. Yes, we have to deal with processes, but yes, we also have to find instant solutions for our pressing needs today. And with our biobotanic approach, we are trying to offer specific solutions, context-specific solutions for the different timelines of different also social and urban environments we have.
Thanks a lot. So then another question, which is, I think, for Monika. So Sarah asks, since you mentioned that there's a food desert aspect to the solution that urban gardening present, she wants to know, do you know if there's any research on the demographics of where these projects are most commonly appearing? Or in other words, are low income and disadvantaged communities the ones who are developing the most urban gardens?
Yeah, thanks for the question. That's a good one and a tricky one. So I don't know if the food desert term is something that perhaps is, Ameri-centric or US-centric. So these are then predominantly neighborhoods that are within, low income, usually low income people of immigrant backgrounds that are, where food deserts are, or they live in food deserts. And there's usually because, these stores that may provide a lot of fresh fruits and vegetables don't see the incentive to move into that neighborhood to provide those kind of amenities. And so often what happens is that in these neighborhoods, they sell apples or a few fresh fruits and vegetables at corner shops. And so a lot of the urban farming initiatives that have happened in these low income neighborhoods that have been started by usually organizations that receive grant money funded by the city or from a foundation because they see a need in that community. Or maybe there's also community members that have voiced that they would like to start a community garden. So most of these, most of the food deserts are located within low-income neighborhoods, and these initiatives that are happening are usually in some way supported by an organization, some sort of social organization that supports the community to start a farming initiative or gardening initiative. Did that answer your question? I lost the question. I don't know where it went. I answered. Okay.
Maybe another question from my side, because I was in the last semester doing a lot with vertical farming. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering because of course vertical farming cannot solve the insect problem that you mentioned, and also not solve the has not anything to do with the social aspect that you also mentioned. So do you see vertical farming quite critical, or are these do we need both, or what is your perspective on vertical farming? Because I think maybe from what I understand from it, it's also quite disadvantaged when I'm trying to get your perspective that the insects there are not really included in the whole process, right?
Ferdinand, did you want to say something?
Yeah, I have a very strong opinion on that. So that's okay. Why I would, but I don't want to kick you off.
No, you can say it. Go for it.
Because on the one hand, we are also doing research on this broader topic of verticality and farming. We have the project Agriculture and Lighting Facade, where we are trying to make double use of the light that comes through the window of an office building. Yeah, and also from the fact that in the night, very many office buildings are illuminated and they look like greenhouses. It's very funny. Yeah, and we just put plants in the window, and in the night we are illuminating them, so we're advertising the building, and in the day we reduce the impact of the sun a bit. But what we are doing here is, in this project, is we have strong interaction with the users of the building. So we have a multi-use space where we are going directly into the office space, and not making isolated boxes as these vertical farms are normally. They are high-tech facilities, which is fine, but completely decoupled from the environment, which is, in my eyes, yesterday's technology, limiting the environmental impact to control them because we are not able, simply because we are not able to deal with complexity. And we were just applying for a second grant in this project where we are applying for support from the artificial intelligence guys that help us with decision support. We simply want to adapt to the very unique climate in an office, making the right species decision, making the right maintenance decisions, not dictating which plant should grow where, but learning from this eco environment, indoor environment. We have an Alexander von Humboldt fellow also at my chair, and she is working on indoor ecosystems. So it is not only the unique question of insects or not insects if they are integrated, but it is a question of, do we understand these systems as environments, as ecosystems, or do we understand them just as stupid machines? Sorry to say, really stupid machines, but stupid machines need a lot of resources to be built, to be maintained, to be driven, and they are very fragile. That's why they are, for example, sterile. Yeah, in these vertical farms, there's no reason to have a sterile production. Why? I mean, outside plants also survive. And indoor, we have just another climate. We have another microclimate. We have a different microbiota. We have to deal with this. But making everything sterile is a quite a strange idea in the 21st century, from my opinion.
Yeah, and I guess I will just follow up. I think that these technologies that like completely decouple people from the food production process or from ecos, like thinking about, yeah, the environment or the complexity of ecosystems, that is why we're in so many problems today. And so I agree with Ferdinand that these are old ways of thinking about this, and we need to get people also involved in, I don't know. I mean, these big questions about how to feed the world or how to regreen the world, help people feed themselves or help people regreen their neighborhoods. And I think we need people to understand more about it. Instead of putting food production into a black box vertical farm that people can't see and don't understand how these lights work or this technology works, that furthers us from the food production process. And I like Fernand's idea, like that concept where you also get people that are working in that office building to engage with food production, to think about their office building as a multifunctional productive space, both in their work and in producing fruits and vegetables. And I think that's a clever way to rethink buildings. They need to be multifunctional. Our cities need to be multifunctional. Our green spaces need to be multifunctional. And I would say that we can use urban agricultural spaces, vertical farming spaces, to create a civic space for learning and engagement. And I would say that that's a better way to approach vertical farming than to create these black boxes where there's no windows, where there's all artificial light that people don't understand. I think that that's where I see vertical farming extremely critically, when they're just even more controlled and decoupled from what we can imagine about how food is produced.
Yeah, thanks. This is really another insight that I wasn't really aware of before, because I have mainly seen the positive aspects of, feeding the world, etc., that you just mentioned. But yeah, so another question which is linked to what you have just said before, Monika. So there's one person asking, Germany has a huge problem with space consumption, dedicating about additional 60 hectares for building purposes every day. How can urban gardening and urban densification come together?
Yeah, where is this question? Is it in the answered ones?
No. It's the last one. I like from, okay. No, not the last one there.
Second class.
Germany has a huge problem with space consumption, dedicating about additional. Yeah. I mean, ideally, I would say that, in the planning process, in neighborhood planning processes, or in any kind of planning processes, we should have urban gardening be a part of these plans. And whether or not that is, I would just say that it should be intentional to. And that's how you would have them come together. I don't know if that's a very, very big insight, but to explicitly have urban gardening and the right to grow your own food, or the right to engage in planting and getting your hands dirty as a part of a neighborhood or a building plan. That's just, one way is to have it very explicitly within plans. But Marcus wants to say something. I mean, for what has already been built, a lot of these container gardening is a solution, or one approach. So I see also another comment was about, the importance of having that paved area on the campus for events and the conflict of space. But I mean, how many days do those events occur a year? And we could then maybe set up these container gardens, like at the Werksviertel, they have these boxes of these paletten, whatever you would call them, that they shift around all the time. And when there's event, the boxes go to the side, and otherwise they creatively, it seems like each time that I'm there, they've like reshifted the ways that these container boxes with trees and shrubs and wildflowers and also vegetables are distributed within this otherwise paved surface. So yes, these paved surfaces are super important for these social events, but I would say that the rest of the time, we can also creatively create these novel ecosystems, and out of these beds, raised beds, and then to move them to the side when we want to use that space for other social purposes.
Maybe Ferdinand wants to add something, but I'm not sure.
Marcus, you are raising your hands.
Yeah. I can jump on that, and it's linked and it's also linked to some of the questions. So first of all, thanks for this super amazing interesting ideas and insights. This is a typical social science question now. Thinking about, and we talked about this the last in the last talks as well, and I would be interested in your opinion here. So I could imagine that in both of your topics and your research your application areas, you're dealing with lots of regulatory hurdles. So what are the main ones, and how do you overcome them? And a linked aspect to that is a main takeaway from the last talks was like, how important it is, especially if you have such a holistic approach like you have, to understand, and here I quote Andreas Franke from last week, like understanding the DNA of the organization and the ideas of the different stakeholders. So the question, and kind of like, not only with regard to regulatory hurdles, but also with regard to how can we convince people that might be critical? What are the main frames that you use in order to convince people, like, this is a good idea? I think we don't need to, convince the ones that are on the street Fridays, demonstrating for a better world, but, the others, right? What are the main stories that you use in order to convince them that this is the only, way forward or common sense forward?
Good question. Monika, do you have an answer already?
I mean, the best thing is to, yeah, for me, I don't know, this is like a very, this is like an, a personal example, but I would say just to bring people that may be skeptics to, yeah, to some of my favorite community gardens. And I have, yeah, brought city policymakers or people that actually, yeah, that sit in city council to see how, yeah, immigrant farmers that really depend on, this was in California, that depended on these sites to feed their families, to sit down to, yeah, bringing policymakers to sit down and, yeah, shuck corn with gardeners. And I think that these kind of experiences are some ways in which you can, yeah, create some sort of experience for these people that make these big decisions about why these spaces are valuable, why these green spaces are important for citizens. And I mean, that's just, yeah, an antidote. And I mean, yeah, it's important to have, yeah, these people in my perspective that make decisions on whether a community garden is getting slotted for a soccer field or for other conflicting land uses or for an apartment building, is to try and get them to experience the space the way that the public that uses that space does.
Yeah, regarding these hurdles you were mentioning, I mean, I have this never-ending conflict with the building codes, you can imagine. Yeah. And why is that taking place? Because I think there are two things. At first, if we go into the tradition of European building codes on the urban level, we think it's separation at first. This is the core thing. If we make decisions on land use first, we have either or we have agricultural land or we have urban development. We have a street or a square or a building or a tree. I mean, sometimes there's a tree on the square, but it's much about separation and not so much about synergies and multifunctionalities. This is comes from the modern tradition, basically, on separating industrial production from the living space, because industrial production is dangerous and hazardous and so on. So, and this is completely outdated, and we have to really get it on a new ground. And the second is that also comes from this era of the Industrial Revolution is the standardization. So our building codes, they come from the time where steel was developed, where concrete was developed, and where all these industrial products were developed that were new. There was no intuitive relation for the people to deal with this. And they were standardizable. And wood basically is not so easy to standardize. Now it is, and now we have standardized wood products. But you can see with our projects, we have no standard at all. And the interesting thing is that the reason of the standardization is that the means to deal with the diversity and complexity of differences were not there. The mathematical methods to calculate were super simple at these times where these things are based. Now we have incredible simulation techniques. We have incredible measurement techniques, sensoring techniques. We could much more dynamically react, for example, on a tree, dangerous tree growth, if this tree is safe or not, by documenting its movement in the wind, with quite basically with a smartphone, you know, as we did with our photogrammetry. I mean, these things are done. These are fantastic 3D models. They are done with this thing. Yeah, this is 200 euro, and everybody has. And then we have to bring it to a standard that comes from a completely different era. And I think here we really also have to find new ground on, yeah, updating all these codes. We have no other solution, because we very often run into the waste of resources by making things five times more strong than necessary, because we are calculating things on a standard that is completely outdated.
Okay. Marcus, do you want to say?
Just thank you.
Okay. I also, can I just follow up on like a random thought? I mean, but this is something that is kind of tangential, but I think it's interesting, is this like planned, everything needs to, this is something I haven't seen necessarily before coming to Germany and coming to Munich specifically, but how gardeners will say, well, we have planned this area for insects and the rest of the garden is for us. And then we create this like this insect visa, this like Blumenwiese for the insects. And this is what they show us. This is what I constantly get shown. And I think that that's a very interesting kind of, just to get at what Ferdinand was saying, is that people don't really necessarily think of these as like multifunctional, very heterogeneous interacting systems. Like if you plant a Blumenwiese or a wildflower patch at one little corner, in one little corner of the garden, that doesn't necessarily mean that the insects will only experience that little patch. Like they will experience the entire system and will utilize the entire garden as a habitat. And so I think it's just, that's just like a, to say that it's very much a mindset. I think people have a very difficult time thinking about these interactions that happen within an ecosystem and to promote these synergies that we want to. So yeah, I think that that's definitely a hurdle. Yeah.
Okay, so then one last, maybe not the last one, but let's see. So there's one aspect that we didn't talk about yet. So the economic aspect or the economic dimension. And the question is to both speakers. So what is the economic dimension of your ideas, approaches? Do they cause extra costs or can they be redeemed in the long run, purely economically?
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. I would say that, I would say that urban gardening and urban farming, if you were to rely on that for your food production, then you could probably not. I guess it depends. If I needed to produce my own food, I could probably not sit in front of Zoom for 8 hours a day. And we think about my education, how much I cost to the Bavarian government or the TUM. It's a very expensive practice or a very expensive, So what is the economic cost? I think when we think about time, when we think about labor, urban gardening can be very expensive. And yeah, just because of the, at least in Germany, if we're thinking about this, the people that may be doing it, their skills may be valued very differently. But if we also think about especially urban gardening as a recreational activity and these benefits that are not necessarily have a price sticker on them, like stress relief or making friends and creating a bond to a place, then there's studies that have done the calculations of when they say, okay, yes, we account for all of these inputs that go into urban agriculture. But if we also think, and then it's really not economically sustainable, like how, like the dollar per kilogram of food of produce is exorbitant. It's so expensive. But if we actually think about this practice as also has these other benefits and people do it for recreation and do not consider it as work per se, then it's extremely efficient. So it's very much depends on how we value from an economic perspective, labor and our time. So I think, that's my take on that. I would say that it really also just is very context dependent from an economic perspective because of the land costs. So urban agriculture in Munich is fundamentally more expensive than urban agriculture in Detroit, where you can buy it. I have friends that bought houses for, I don't know, $2,000 or something like that. So, I mean, the land prices are just so different and you need land, or in most cases, not all cases, but you often need access to land to realize urban agriculture. So it depends. Yeah. Yeah,
it's a very tricky question, but I think the first problem is that the costs and benefits are distributed completely unequally. So we have, if we make a green building, no matter if this, we are, for example, working on a tree facade research project at the moment, applying our research for social housing. And there it's really hard to meet the budget, honestly, because things are not cheap. But the benefits are not only for paying back for those who are investing in the building, but they are paying back for the whole community, everybody that is benefiting from this. And it is possible to calculate these benefits, and then we are coming into a positive direction. So if we calculate the cooling effect of this to the city, if we calculate the social effect, if we calculate also the health effect, yeah. So the biggest natural catastrophe we had so far in Europe was the hot summer 2003 with 60,000 people dying. If we see this at billions and billions of euros of health cost, if we can reduce this just a little bit, it pays back. On the other hand, we have to say, yes, there are super high and sophisticated overpriced green systems on the markets with several thousand euros per square meter. This is not a role model. We have to be honest in this direction. This is a kind of a prestige thing, which is nice to have. I don't have anything against this, but we shouldn't sell this as a solution for everybody. And on the other hand, we have to say what Monika was saying, there is economy and there is capitalistic speculation on ground. And this I will not follow this logic, honestly. I will not compare our costs with these logics. If you make, for example, a very sophisticated green facade on a high-rise building, the costs are increasing. The building costs are increasing around 500 euro per square meter for the flat, living space. But they are selling this flat for around in Munich 10,000 euro, 11,000 euro per square meter. 70% of this is capitalistic speculation. It has nothing to do with the building cost. So in comparison to what we pay for this speculation, all green solutions are super cheap. Yeah, we have to be quite honest in this.
Okay, so it is already over time, but do you have maybe, 8 more minutes or something? Because we have still some questions or...
Yeah, maybe one more. We can't. I think we have 7 more, which is in midnight probably when we answer all questions. Very nice, very great discussions. But maybe Leah, you are choosing, so just some.
The last question.
Randomly, huh?
Okay. Then maybe we take this one. Are there any possibilities to use living systems to renovate or upgrade existing buildings, or is the approach just for new buildings? Because I think the pictures that you have showed us were mainly also from new buildings, so what's your answer here?
It's for both of us, I guess, but maybe I can start it is more difficult with existing buildings than for sure with new buildings. This is quite obvious because creating the root space, for example, for trees is a very tricky part. And it's almost impossible to create this on top of existing structures when they are not strong enough. And also underground, you might have conflicts with the old foundations and old infrastructure. Yeah. But there are solutions, definitely. Yeah, so there are different solutions. We also, for example, have very light constructions for green roofs. They don't need to be heavy. Yeah, we can have just some centimeters of soil or just like layers of mosses and things like these that have more or less the same weight than a normal roof. And we also have these containerized solutions. We have one research project about trees in pots, which we can place everywhere on any steel surface, also on the campus, for example, and wherever, which we also can put on constructions, which is very interesting. Construction do not have the same loading capacity everywhere. So in the middle of a span, they are weak, and at the columns, they are strong. So we can put some pots with trees on these stronger areas and leave the other areas free. It needs a very clever planning and a very clever design, and not all solutions are possible for old buildings. But it's more, I would say, a question of willing and not of the technical possibilities. So by the way, as you probably know, the state of Bavaria has committed itself to green every roof and every facade of the same old buildings they start from building now. And even if they renovate a state old building, they have to include a green roof and a green facade. So we need to see many solutions for existing structures in the coming years, especially in Bavaria.
Yeah, I mean, I will just say, yeah, I mean, there's I think Fernand brought up a good point about even on these old buildings, you can use different substrates. So there's a lot of research looking at biochar and how that can be used for urban gardening on rooftops because it's very light and can also offer these nutrients that plants may need. So I think that there are these new technologies that can be used utilizing different practices that can be used to also still realize these urban greening initiatives on old buildings as well.
Okay. Thanks a lot. So I think we will end here now. Thanks a lot for this great discussion and the very interesting insights that you gave us. I think you can see that there was a lot of interest in what you are doing. And yeah, I also hope that we will see maybe a planted rooftop or more raised beds at the TUM. And so thanks a lot to both of you. And next week, we will have our last lecture of our lecture series, Digitainability, for this semester. And then next semester, of course, we have more lectures about it, but this will be it for then. And next week, we will have a look back and sum up what we have learned from this semester. And we will talk about what needs to be done that universities get more digital and sustainable at the same time, and especially what TUM can do. So thanks a lot, and also to the audience for being with us and staying with us today, and see you next week. Bye.
Thank you for my end. It was very nice, very lively, great fun, and a really great approach. Looking forward to the next steps that will come out from your initiative.
Yeah, thank you also from my end. And yeah, I hope the rest of the semester goes well. Thanks.